Previously on Rob Plays. It was 1984 and Disney wanted to get into the cruise industry. Unfortunately, cruise ships are really expensive, so they partnered with Premier Cruise Line, who offered Disney cruises on the Big Red Boat. Things were great. In 1994, the partnership ended. Premier decided to partner with Warner Brothers instead. It worked out well for them, until it didn't. Disney tried to partner with the Royal Caribbean Cruise Line. It didn't work out. Disney tried to partner with the Carnival Cruise Line. It also didn't work out. So Disney decided it was finally time for them to just spend the money and start their own cruise line. The Disney Cruise Line. In the late 1980s and early 1990s, when it came to entertainment and vacation ventures, Disney's philosophy was that the best approach was to take a crash course in the industry in question and take a try at it themselves. They believed that their methodology to entertainment was unique, and that applying it to these new ventures allowed them to do it the Disney way. For reasons mentioned in the last video, which you should check out before watching this one, Disney simply couldn't do that with cruises. But as their partnership options ran dry in 1994, Disney was in a much better financial situation compared to a decade prior when they first wanted to get into the industry. So they decided that it was finally time to do what they always did best, which was to approach the venture the Disney way. Disney Cruise Vacations, as it was referred to at the time, was announced in May of 1994, but it would be over 4 years before any ships would set sail. Disney decided that instead of buying secondhand ships, which cruise lines would sometimes do to build a fleet, they would have two brand new ships built from scratch. Disney was prepared to pay $400 million per ship, and they wanted to get off on the right foot, so they hired industry veteran Arthur Rodney to lead the venture. Just 6 years earlier, Rodney had successfully led the launch of Crystal Cruises, which is still around today. Similar to the structure of their old partnership with Premier, Disney initially planned to offer cruises to the Bahamas that sailed out of Port Canaveral and that were packaged with short stays at Walt Disney World. It made the most sense. While Miami was the larger port in Florida for cruises, Port Canaveral was just 60 miles east of Walt Disney World, and if Disney loved one thing, it was synergy. The company would hire Italian shipbuilders Fincantieri to build the two ships while the design would be completed in Norway with the help of Walt Disney Imagineering. The 85,000-ton ships, later named the Disney Magic and the Disney Wonder, would be able to hold up to 2,500 passengers each. Disney didn't just want their famous magic to be apparent through the entertainment and the crew on the ships. They wanted the ships themselves to feel like they had that special Disney touch. You see, at that time, the family cruise market was still just a small part of the overall industry. It had certainly grown thanks to Disney's involvement with Premier, but it wasn't what it is today. Disney wanted to design a ship that would not only appeal to families with children, but to adults without children as well. At a time where many cruise lines were catering towards one group or the other, Disney was aiming to win over both. One way of doing that was by designing the two ships to offer staterooms that were 25% larger than the industry standard at the time in order to better accommodate families with children. They also wanted to make sure there was enough for kids to do while on the ship, and so an unprecedented 15,000 square feet, almost an entire ship deck, was exclusively set aside as space for children's activities. That said, it wasn't enough to just have entertainment options for kids. In order to truly appeal to both audiences, it was important that the ship also had options for those who wanted to avoid the more family-centric offerings. For instance, the ship would have three separate pools, one for adults only, one for kids only, and one for everybody. This tactic would also be used with dining, as the ship offered, among others, an upscale adult-only restaurant. Even the island the ships docked at would have both a general beach area for everybody, as well as a quiet adults-only beach area. Meanwhile, once Disney made their pick of Port Canaveral official, the Canaveral Port Authority got to work at building a $27 million terminal for the two ships. Disney would pay to lease the terminal and operate it themselves. The Port Authority was more than happy to pick up the tab on building the terminal. They estimated that the introduction of Disney cruise ships would have a positive economic impact of up to $100 million annually between the lease, the port fees, and the jobs created. They even hoped that Disney picking the port as its home would entice other cruise lines to choose Port Canaveral in the future. In fact, if there was one word to describe the general reaction to Disney's decision to move into the cruise industry, It was hopeful. Even competing cruise lines felt that Disney's arrival would help them more than it would hurt. They believed that the Disney name would attract many first-time cruise passengers who might then be willing to explore other cruise options down the line. Disney themselves even believed that as many as 90% of their initial passengers might potentially be first-timers. On top of that, while Disney was promising to offer a top-of-the-line experience with the Magic and Wonder, it would also come with a top-of-the-line price. So other cruise lines felt safe in knowing that the Disney Cruise Line wouldn't eat into the market of passengers looking for a more economical vacation. Now, if at this point anyone still doubted Disney's dedication to diving headfirst into the cruise industry, those doubts would be put to rest when Disney purchased a 99-year lease on their own private island in the Bahamas called Gorda Key. Later renamed Castaway Key before opening, it would be a stop along the way for the two ships. I originally planned to go more into the island, but there's enough of an interesting history behind this place that I've decided to dedicate an entire video just to Castaway Key in the future, so keep an eye out for that. By all accounts, it appeared that Disney was committed to making sure that their entrance into the cruise industry would be grand and smooth, and for a while, that's how it was going. Unfortunately, it wouldn't be the case for long. In October of 1997, Disney was just 6 months away from their planned launch of the first cruise of the Disney Magic. Many families were likely getting excited for their upcoming Disney cruise, but unfortunately, they would learn that the maiden voyage of the Disney Magic was to be delayed to April of 1998. Disney cited construction issues in Italy as the reason for the delay. It was disappointing, no doubt, but what could you do? One positive result of the delay was that with an April 1998 launch date, Disney could plan one grand celebration to mark not only the start of Disney Cruises, but also the opening of Disney's Animal Kingdom, which was slated to open its gates that same month. 4 months later, those same families were once again growing excited for their upcoming Disney cruise, and were once again disappointed when they were informed that the ships were once again delayed. This time, the delay was over 2 months, and the maiden voyage was pushed back to July 30th. This delay was especially painful for Disney. For one, they had to scrap their joint Animal Kingdom / Disney Cruise launch celebration, but more importantly, it began to hurt their credibility. For years, the hype of Disney's cruise line was building, and one constant question being asked was whether or not they could pull off the famous Disney magic when it came to a cruise. Now, at a time where the press coverage should have been all about the excitement for the upcoming voyage, the media story was instead about the string of setbacks. It raised the question of whether or not Disney knew what they were doing. Once more, construction issues were cited as the cause of the delay. Officially, both Disney and Fincantieri pointed to a shortage in supplies and persistent weather problems as the two main issues. The cruise industry was growing at a faster rate at that point, and so Europe saw a spike in ships being built during that time. Fincantieri was busy building 11 cruise ships at that point, and Disney wouldn't ultimately be the only cruise line to be hit with delays. That said, there are others both within Disney and within Fincantieri who put part of the blame on Disney, claiming that their perfectionism, constantly revised plans, and unique designs for the custom ships played a large part in the two delays. In any case, the setbacks would affect a total of 26 voyages, and Disney tried to placate the understandably disappointed passengers by offering 25% off of the vacations for those families impacted by one delay, and 50% off of the vacations for those impacted by both. And it worked, because cancellations were kept to a minimum and the vast majority of families ended up rescheduling.
Presenting the most long-awaited cruise ship ever, the Disney Magic. From Disney Cruise Line, now sailing.
With no other delays in sight, the Disney Magic made its way to Port Canaveral that July, and it was reported that up to 10,000 people showed up to the port to watch the arrival. Like most ventures into something new, there were some logistical and service hiccups during the first few cruises, but nothing disastrous. Disney would quickly iron out the wrinkles and go on to show everyone who was still asking that, yes, they could bring that famous Disney Magic to the cruise industry. Within a matter of years, the cruise line was not only growing in popularity, but winning awards and accolades from all manner of publications for their level of quality and service. A couple of years later, in 2000, Disney would expand their offerings to a 7-night cruise in the Bahamas. And the following year, in 2001, Disney would begin hinting that more ships were planned for the future. After that, the word to best describe the Disney Cruise Line was growth. They began to sail to more locations, including Europe in 2006. In 2007, they announced that two new ships, the Disney Dream and the Disney Fantasy, would be joining the fleet in 2011 and 2012. Just recently, in 2016, it was announced that two more ships, yet to be named, would be joining the fleet in the future. And as if that wasn't enough, a third upcoming ship was announced last year. The three new ships are expected to set sail in 2021, 2022, and 2023. Today, the Disney Cruise Line covers it all. They offer cruises that are as short as 2 nights and as long as 2 weeks. Destinations that range from the Bahamas to Europe to Alaska and Mexico and more. Thanks to the wonderful cast members, they continue to win awards for their fantastic service. And with 3 more ships on the way, it seems they have no intention of slowing down. The Disney Cruise Line serves as yet another example of their ability to bring that famous Disney magic somewhere new.